for that.
Sumit, can you tell us a little bit about your role and also about auto lending technology and consumer lending technology?
Yeah, absolutely. Can you all hear me? Yep. Thumbs up? All right. I hear we are in between drinks, so hopefully we get some questions at least. But my role at Wells Fargo, like you said, Jed, it's I lead the indirect auto lending business. So what that means is that for Wells at the current time, Wells Fargo, all our auto loans are originated through dealers. So we have a network of about 11,000 dealers through which we originate the auto loans. We have a total of about 3 million somewhere north or south, depending on the day, of that customers. And it's been one of the marquee consumer lending businesses for Wells Fargo. Now, I've been in this role for just over a year and a half. I joined Wells Fargo back in 2020. And at that point, I was leading a different business. But back in 2021, I came in and started leading the Wells Fargo auto business. And then overall, like, I've been in technology all my career, been in the consumer domain. Prior to Wells, I was at JPM Chase for many years. But being part of the consumer domain, solving for problems that are customer-centric is where I have been through my career.
And so is the consumer lending technology also part of your remit? And how separate are they? Are they all run as one line of business?
So the way we are structured is we have most of the consumer businesses. I say most because with the exception of wealth and investment management, the other consumer businesses like home loans, auto loans, credit cards, personal lending, which are sort of the lending businesses. And then along with that, the branch and the deposits and the ATM side of the business, which is also consumer-centric, is part of one organization, which is where I am. So my leader, he is the group CIO for all these consumer functions, and auto lending is an integral part of that.
I see. And how important are applications and data to the auto lending business?
They're extremely important, and I've been following the conversation throughout the day, and a lot of commonality in terms of the not just the importance of applications and data, but also the life cycle, right, that you go through. And Wells Fargo as an organization has been around for over 170 years. So they've been around for a long, long time. The auto lending business specifically is also a business that's been around for a long time for them. And it's been built over different mergers and acquisitions. And as a result of that, you inherit properties and applications. When I say properties, it's really your intellectual property, right, in terms of applications and data that has been aggregated over a period of time. And that's essentially what we rely on to run this business. So it's extremely important. And what we've done over a period of time is, just like any other major business, similar to the ones we've heard throughout the day, is spent a lot of time and investment in consolidation. But at the present time, what it is a consolidated view of applications and data that runs this portfolio.
And are there a handful of core applications that power the business, and what do those applications do?
Yes, there are. So if you think of any lending business, it's traditionally comprised of three main components. You've got the origination side of the business, where you originate loans, you have your underwriting, you have your funding. Then once you onboard the loans, that's when you get the servicing side of the customers. And then post-servicing, you have things like charge-off and collections and repo and whatnot. So that's sort of the third leg. So across these three towers or pillars is where we have some critical applications which we rely on to run the business. And again, like, our tech stack is comprised of legacy applications, which are largely monoliths. And we've been on this transformation journey where we are writing more and more microservices, having sort of API stitched together for the integration for data internally and externally. But yeah, we still have some of these large monoliths in each of the domains which we rely on to run the business.
And so today you have mainframe, and what other kinds of applications do you have that run your business?
Yeah, so mainframe we primarily have on the servicing and collection side. On the origination side, we don't have mainframe, which is good. But we primarily are a .NET stack. So that's where, you know, we currently have. We are slowly moving over to a Java-centric stack. But and again, like as part of our move to cloud, which I know is a topic we'll get to later, we will be eventually getting past our mainframe environment, which is essentially what we are dependent on to service our customers.
And how many developers do you have across all these different applications? And how would you characterize their developer experience today?
Yeah, so we are roughly, so we are a global organization similar to some of the other ones we heard during the day. So we are roughly 350 to 400 developers for this business. But then that's just primarily in this organization. If you think of Wells Fargo, across the consumer domain, we have many consumer products, right? So we also have a lot of enterprise assets that we rely on, whether that is for like document management, whether that is for data management, whether that is for like online integration. So I'm not counting those because again, we rely on them to run the business, but they're not directly in this domain per se. But the developer experience is one that still has a lot of improvement that needs to happen. Because right now, it is very much dependent. I mean, we have like the typical stack where we have a pipeline that we rely on for CI and CD. We have DevOps that is getting integrated. It's not a separate organization. But still where, you know, because we have a lot of compliance, a lot of regulations that we have to serve, being a financial institution, there is still a decent population of our developer productivity that goes into functions that are non-engineering centric. So which is where, like, you know, striving towards getting over 80% of their time to get to into writing code is where we are. Right now, we are somewhere in the 60-65% range.
60 to 65% is still pretty good, at least in our experience working with a lot of companies. So that's quite good.
Yep.
When you think about all the digitization that occurred during the pandemic, and the changes that you probably made to your applications, and now we're in a new mode. What are the priorities now for customer experience, and how are you looking at the new way of handling digital in this hybrid mode?
Yeah, so for us, fortunately, we were on this roadmap even before the pandemic, where one of the key imperatives, as you can imagine, is to bring parity in experiences for our customer. And what I mean by that is, like, if you, as a customer of Wells Fargo, get onto your mobile app, it should feel seamless to you that, you know, you are a customer who has access to all your products in one go. And that wasn't the case from where we started. So for this business, which is auto lending specifically, we've been on this journey to bring parity in terms of experiences for our customers, where it's not a fragmented experience where if you clicked on your auto loan in the mobile app, it routes you over to a web page and takes you out of the mobile app itself. That's how it was previously. But over the past 2 to 3 years, we've invested heavily in terms of bringing parity and then also adding more and more enhancements where our customers can do more functions within the mobile app, whether it's directly for the product that they have or even to get other things like offers and options that they can choose from.
So you've unified more of the customer experience for your customers. Did you have to get to customer 360 first? Did you first have to get a full view of your own customers across all the data and systems, or were you able to do it by stitching it across a single app?
It's been a journey, Jed. I mean, as you can imagine, ideal state would be what you're describing, but in order to get to ideal state, there are multiple steps and multiple hops that you have to get through. So what we have done is we have imagined what the view should look like for a customer, but then for each of the businesses, through their investments and through their specific roadmaps, we've been working on getting that 360 view pulled together, which is what it looks like very much. And culmination of that was, if you follow, like Wells Fargo mobile app has won many awards in the past couple of years because of the work we've done there to give that 360 view.
And when you think about the roadmap, what are the biggest things that are coming that could make a material impact on the business?
Yeah, so it's across all the three dimensions that I talked about earlier. So we're on the origination side, and I'll answer that question in terms of our strategy, right? So our strategy has been, over a three-year period, focus on digitization, integration, and automation. So digitization we covered in some detail, on the servicing side, but on the origination side, digitizing the experience where, as a customer, you can get an enablement to know what loan options you can get if you're in the market shopping for an auto loan, right? So through our dealer network, giving them that ability to understand the rates and terms and understand what options they can have, that's part of our roadmap from an origination standpoint. On the automation front, again, as I described the history, coming together for this particular business, historically, this was an overly manual run business, right? So we've, over time, spent our investments in automating as much of our funding and underwriting experience, which again, like works wonders for the business and for our customers. And then the third one is the integration, which again, we are one Wells Fargo, which means that for customers, we want to give that unified experience, and we want to integrate with enterprise assets, both for experiences as well as for data. So that's been a three-year strategy where we are consciously going after utilizing our data, utilizing our applications across the enterprise to bring that one Wells Fargo experience for the customers. And that's, again, a three-year strategy across three dimensions.
How important is data compliance when it comes to GDPR, CCPA, PCI compliance? How challenging is that to manage for your business?
It's extremely important, and again, it comes with the territory, right? So Wells Fargo being one of the top financial institutions, we do not just like look after the data, but have to comply and have to be compliant from a regulatory standpoint. So things like masking for the data, things like encrypting the data, whether it's at rest or in transit, things like, you know, ensuring that we have sources of data, right, that are common for a given customer or for a given customer attribute. So all those things then lead to the point where if we didn't do this right, compliance is an item that can really be impacted. So that's where, again, whenever we talk about investments, whenever we talk about strategy over a three-year period, data is a core component of that. And ensuring having safe, compliant data, which is serving purpose for a given customer, is what we keep at the center of it.
And where are you along the journey, and what is your strategy for cloud and CI/CD?
Yeah, so from a cloud perspective, we have what we call it as a data digital infrastructure strategy and program. So the commitment that Wells Fargo has made is over a 10-year period, which started in 2021, we will be investing in a public cloud strategy. And where we've anchored ourselves is investing in Microsoft Azure, as well as GCP, the Google public cloud. So it's not like we are starting our journey in 2021. We already have had our journey more on the private cloud, but over the next 8-9 years remaining now, the focus will be to shift and continually shift over to the public cloud offering with the two providers of choice that I just named. And what that also does is that, and again, like it's not an overnight shift, like we are being very thoughtful and structured in our approach and execution. And I think in one of the sessions, there was a discussion around having the redundancy and resiliency from a cloud perspective. So yes, this provides us that, but also when you think of data, and putting the data in a public cloud environment, that's where for the next 8 or 9 years, there's a lot of investment and a lot of focus in ensuring that we can move these applications in a safe and secure way over to the public cloud.
Fantastic. And when you think about data in general, how well do you think you're optimizing the use of data for your line of business? And what are some of the opportunities that you might employ in the future?
Yeah, so what we are doing well is, again, we have a chief data office, right, for the firm, where we do get a lot of guidelines and a lot of policies and procedures, which sort of blend the periphery of change management, right? So as an organization the size we are, change management is critical to our success. And keeping in mind, especially data governance and ensuring data is always cared for, we always look at change management across different verticals. So we always look at our North Star, which is provided through the Chief Data Office, in ensuring that, you know, we are caring for the data, not just for a specific domain or a specific product, but for the customer overall. Now, things that we have to still solve for, which we are solving for gradually, are some of the things that we talked about, having safe and sound test data, having integrity of the data, right, and regardless of the environment you're in. So those are some of the investments which I won't say that we are not doing well. We know we have some gaps there, but we are consciously working towards getting past those.
Now, we're sorry we missed you last night, but you're here, Mike Brady, the CTO, accepted the award for sustainability on behalf of Wells Fargo. How important is sustainability to you and your business?
Yeah, I mean, I really wanted to be there for the session yesterday, and I'm sure I'll see him tomorrow morning for a different event in Charlotte, so I'm sure he'll give me some grief for missing the award function, but thank you for having him and recognizing, you know, through Sustainable IT for the work that him and his team is doing. But some of the data points around sustainability, it's extremely important for Wells Fargo. And what you will see is through the commitments we've made, and I'll talk through some of those commitments, is we've committed to be a net zero greenhouse gas emission company, and that includes financed emissions as well. Now, that makes us look at the entire businesses, including our operations, to make sure we are complying between now and 2050. That's one. The second one that we have is we have committed over $500 billion in sustainable finance over the 8 or 9 year period, which means that we will be funding companies and organizations that are focused on sustainment, right, through various efforts. And part of that investment will also be going in to fund science programs to make sure that wherever companies are investing or research grants are investing in getting to zero or no carbon emission, we are providing funding to that. Along with that, the third thing that I can remember is that in 2021, Wells Fargo launched a Sustainable Finance Institute, which again focuses on partnering and ensuring that whenever we lend, we are lending responsibly to the financial institutions and other institutions which are having an eye towards sustainability. And then along with that, we have various other investments, like one that comes to mind because I'm in North Carolina is for our power consumption, we have about 600 acres of land where we have solar panels. We have another 100 or so locations where we are investing in adding more solar panels. And all this is in addition to the efforts that are already underway in terms of consolidation of real estate assets, reducing the carbon footprint where we can, and a host of other things. So basically all to say that this is something that is extremely close to the operating committee, to the company's vision overall, and the investments that I stated demonstrate that.
We've covered quite a range of topics that I'll touch on how you can drive the new customer experience or the continued customer experience that you noted before. Do you have some insights or key lessons learned that you'd like to share with the audience?
Yeah, and it's been interesting because I think the topic that I remember we started to talk about was innovating the customer experience, right, in a post-pandemic world. And I still remember vividly that, you know, like, because I started with Wells Fargo during the pandemic, and there was always this conversation around, well, how can we innovate where the focus is all on compliance and risk and controls and whatever products, right, that we are looking to roll out. And to me, like, they're not mutually exclusive. If you're not innovating, if you're not enabling your teams, if you're not investing time and effort down to every single developer level, you're missing the opportunity. So which is one of the things that we've very actively done in the groups that I work with is that it, like, innovation and coming up with new ideas, investing in newer technologies shouldn't be an event. It should be something that is part of the fabric of every developer that's part of the organization. And the way you harness that is by ensuring there is time allocated, there is enablement from the product as well, to make sure that the developers are getting the time and effort to innovate in sprint, right? They don't have to reserve time, they don't have to wait for the next hackathon to come out and with the next brilliant idea. So that's just one small thing that we've done that's yielded us as good benefits. From a customer experience standpoint, this is where, like, you know, we obviously have investments on the digital front for the ones I stated from a mobile banking standpoint, but also for our internal users, which are either our call center agents or our internal employees. We are also investing in customer experience through UX investments to make sure that whatever experience they have is a digital first experience, so that we we are reducing some of the green screens, right? Some of the green screens that we still have, or before we can fully eliminate them, we are creating more intuitive experiences so that even the workforce that is currently there or will be joining us in the future is motivated with the experience that they're exposed to. So again, those are things that we consciously have to work on in every sprint and every iteration, and that's what we've been up to.
Wonderful. I think we have a little bit of time for questions, so let me open it up to the audience.
How are you guys doing up there? Thank you for your time today. You mentioned your team's like 400 or 500 people as far as developers go. The scale of Wells is obviously massive. What are you doing to guide transformation, innovation, sustainability efforts to make sure that all the groups are kind of driving consistently as opposed to each solving the same problem in different ways?
Yeah, that's a good question. So what we've done is that, and again, this has been a journey where we very much started from the standpoint of having like a waterfall organization where you had projects that you were executing. Over the past few years, the way that has evolved is we now have named products at a domain level. And then within products, we have sub-products that, you know, whether it's originations and then originations, you have different subdomains, right? You can have pricing, you can have funding, so on and so forth. Similarly on the servicing and collection side as well. So what that does is that like in that first step itself, that reduces duplication at a product line level, which is auto lending. So that's one. Additionally, we've followed that same approach across all consumer products. So when we think of a product, which is, let's say, a pricing engine, right? There is a common vernacular across the organization, which we call it banking product and platform architecture. So that is something that we leverage across Wells Fargo to have common elements that businesses can leverage so that there is no duplication. So if I'm building something sitting in auto lending and someone in small business lending wants to use it, they are fully aware that this capability is being built through a certain investment that can be leveraged, that can either be co-created or can be leveraged based on wherever they are in their time frame and in their roadmap. So I think having that same vernacular, that same taxonomy at an enterprise level helps tremendously. And then we obviously follow that within the specific product lines as well.
Excellent. Any additional questions? Probably take one more.
Like we said, it's getting close to drinks.
Getting close to drinks.
Yep.
All right, thank you, Sumit, so much for joining us. We really appreciate all your insights.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
All right, well, this is the wrap-up for the day. Thank you so much to all of our speakers and all of our customers.